Hi everyone. Welcome to today's presentation on what every New Hampshire realtor should know about PFAS and drinking water. My name is Alex Altricio. I'm an analytical chemist working at Absolute Resource Associates in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. Back in 2020, we became the first commercial laboratory in New Hampshire to receive accreditation for the analysis of PFAS in water. I'm here today to give a brief overview of what PFAS is and how it might impact those who own or are looking to own properties in the New England area. Public awareness of just how ubiquitous PFAS is in our daily lives is growing every year. A quick Google search will bring up countless articles similar to those listed here, but there's still a lack of easily digestible knowledge about what exactly PFAS is and just how concerned we should be about it. I'm hoping I can help to pull back the curtain and provide a summary of the available research so that you can better address the questions that your clients might have about PFAS. So let's start with the basic question of what exactly is PFAS? One of the most common misconceptions I hear is that people think of PFAS as just a single compound or a handful of compounds. In reality, it's a lot more complicated. PFAS stands for per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances, and there are thousands upon thousands of different compounds that fall under the blanket term PFAS. However, all of these thousands of compounds are tied together by structural and functional similarities. I won't spend too much time on the nitty-gritty chemistry details in this presentation, but the general gist is that all PFAS compounds are based around one or more fluorinated carbon chains, also called tails, attached to a functional group, the head. The variability in tail length and functional group identity is what allows for the vast number of different PFAS compounds that exist. Pictured on the right is one of the most well-studied PFAS compounds, perfluorooctanoic acid, or PFOA. It's comprised of 8 carbon atoms, 7 of which are fully fluorinated, and the last of which is part of the functional group, in this case, carboxylate. These compounds are all man-made, and they have unique physical and chemical properties that make them highly desirable to industry and manufacturing. They repel oil, water, and solids, useful for waterproofing and stain resistance. They're chemically and thermally stable, so they won't explode or catch on fire. They reduce friction, great for nonstick surfaces, and they're both persistent and resistant, meaning that they can stay on their intended surface for long periods of time and they don't easily break down. To a chemist or an engineer, these compounds are amazing. But as we'll get to later, many of those same properties are what make them concerning to toxicologists and ecologists. Because of their appealing characteristics, PFAS compounds were considered miraculous when they were first synthesized. They rapidly came to market and were incorporated into countless products. They've been used to produce nonstick kitchenware, moisture-proof clothing, carpet, upholstery, cosmetics, lotions, waxes, paints, fast food wrappers, firefighting foams, you name it. The general consensus was that these products made life better. With how many products that PFAS compounds have been used in, you'd think that they've been around for centuries, but in reality, they were first developed in the 1930s. It wasn't until the 2000s that researchers started finding them where they don't belong. The speed of their adoption and the ubiquity of their use is why their presence can now be detected around the entire world and in the blood of every human. Due to their popularity and prevalence in products, PFOA and PFOS became the most well-studied PFAS compounds on the market. As more and more studies raised cause for concern, a voluntary phase-out program was adopted in the U.S. To this day, there is no law banning the manufacture or sale of products containing PFOA or PFOS, but they are still produced internationally, resulting in products containing them being imported to the U.S. PFOA and PFOS are the only two compounds addressed by the voluntary phase-out, so other PFAS replacement compounds, such as Gen-X and 6,2-FTS, are still produced and used domestically. Just because a product is advertised as PFOA or PFOS-free doesn't mean that it's PFAS-free. As new compounds are discovered in the environment, researchers begin the process of cataloging and studying them to determine their potential impact on health and well-being. But it has proven impossible to keep up with the rate that new compounds are being produced and incorporated into products. Pictured below is a diagram of how these compounds travel through the environment and into your bloodstream. If you're interested in diving further into those processes, check out the link at the top right of the slide. ITRCWeb is a scientifically based resource that provides free videos, fact sheets, and studies. I'll also share this link again at the end of the presentation. Now that we've gone over a broad overview of what PFAS is, what it's used for, and where it came from, let's focus on the history that one state, New Hampshire, has with it. New Hampshire was first identified as a PFAS hotspot in 2014, when high levels of PFOS were detected at Pease Trade Port in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. The source of the PFAS contamination at Pease can be traced back to the Pease Air Force Base that operated at this location from 1951 to 1991. During this time period, PFOS-based firefighting foams, were called AFFFs, were commonly used at the Air Force bases all around the world. AFFFs were used during training drills and live fires, after which they were washed off the tarmac, seeping into the groundwater surrounding the base and eventually contaminating the wells that supply the area. The Haven well at Pease was shut down shortly after the discovery of elevated PFOS levels in 2014, and in 2016, the city of Portsmouth installed granular activated carbon filters on two other Pease transport wells, Harrison and Smith. Studies are currently being conducted by the CDC and the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry into the long-term effects that may be experienced by those who are exposed to the contaminated drinking water. As of 2016, elevated PFAS levels have also been discovered in Litchfield and Merrimack, New Hampshire. Both of these occurrences have been linked to the manufacture of plastics. At the time of these discoveries, and this is still true today, there were no federal regulations of PFAS compounds. This left the state of New Hampshire with two options: either follow the EPA's health advisory limit of 70 parts per trillion, or develop their own enforceable maximum contamination levels, also known as MCLs. Since before 2014, many in the scientific community have expressed concern that the 70 part per trillion limit set by the EPA is not conservative enough given the available research. So New Hampshire decided to set their own limits. In 2019, the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services announced their intent to set MCLs for four different PFAS compounds: PFHXS, PFNA, PFOS, and PFOA. As you can see from the table on the right, those limits were set to 18, 11, 15, and 12 parts per trillion, respectively. Many businesses and water suppliers fear that these limits will be difficult and expensive to achieve, as they are some of the lowest limits in the entire country. But environmentalists and impacted citizens argue that even stricter regulations are needed to protect human health and well-being. With how controversial these limits have been, it's no surprise that New Hampshire's proposed MCLs were quickly challenged when the chemical producer 3M filed a lawsuit against the state. However, in 2020, New Hampshire proceeded with the plan, and the proposed PFAS MCLs for drinking water were signed into state statute. That means that PFAS testing is currently required of all public drinking water providers in New Hampshire. Now, all this is just semantics, unless PFAS compounds are actively causing harm. But determining the long-term intergenerational effects of a class of compound that, in the grand scheme of things, are a relatively modern invention is easier said than done. With that being said, the available research does indicate that these compounds are not something that should be ignored. PFAS has been shown to accumulate in the body, and most, if not all, people have some amount of PFAS in their blood already. Those with particularly elevated levels of the most toxicologically dangerous compounds may be more prone to a number of complications, including liver disease, elevated cholesterol levels, risk of kidney or testicular cancer, and low infant birth weight. Because some PFAS can be passed through breast milk, there are even studies that have observed lower vaccine responses in children with elevated PFAS levels. The potential for harmful side effects is certainly concerning. But there's also the fact that while everyone has some amount of PFAS in their blood, most people experience few negative health effects. What's currently lacking is the availability of comprehensive research that identifies which PFAS compounds are the most detrimental and at what concentrations they become dangerous. Until we have a better sense for those factors, it's important to limit our exposure and reduce PFAS usage as much as possible. As I mentioned before, these compounds do accumulate in our bodies. We don't want to reach a point where our children or our grandchildren are exposed at birth to harmful concentrations before we've had time to fully understand the risks involved. As bad as that sounds, it's not all doom and gloom. The good news is that the voluntary phase-out of specific PFAS compounds that began in the 2000s appears to have been effective. Average concentrations of PFOS and PFOA found in blood have significantly decreased since the phase-out began. There are still some caveats to keep in mind, though. This study, performed by the CDC, only looked at four compounds. And as you now know, there are thousands of PFAS compounds, with many replacement chemicals being used widely today. The hope is that as toxicology catches up with the wide variety of PFAS compounds that are out there, we can identify those with the greatest risk potential and take similar actions to limit future exposure. All right. it's time to talk about how exactly all of this relates to real estate transactions. I'll start with some of the basics about water testing. Municipal water, or town water, is regularly monitored and tested per state and federal regulations. These reports are made publicly available, so it should be easy to obtain a snapshot of water quality for any property involved in a real estate transaction that's part of a public water supply. Well water, on the other hand, is not regulated. It's up to the well owner to perform all relevant testing and maintenance. As you cannot see, smell, or taste most contaminants, it's important to maintain a regular testing schedule so that you know exactly what you're drinking. It is highly recommended that anyone purchasing a property that uses private water obtain a recent water report from a certified laboratory before closing on a transaction. Case in point, 1 in 5 wells in New Hampshire test high for arsenic, and 30% of homes tested for radon reported elevated concentrations. Because of these risk factors, some lenders may even require that a basic water test be performed prior to disbursing funds. It's always a good idea to check with the state and local municipality where a property is located to see what testing parameters they recommend. If it's an area that you're not familiar with, they may be able to inform you of risk factors that you weren't aware of, such as nearby industrial sites, manufacturing plants, or landfills. All of these basic principles of water testing also apply to PFAS. Public water systems in New Hampshire and many other states in the New England area provide regular reports on the concentrations of PFAS found in municipal drinking water, but responsibility is on the owner when it comes to private wells. Well owners in known PFAS hotspots such as Seacoast, New Hampshire, and Merrimack should consider adding PFAS testing to their routine water quality monitoring. Here's an example from the latest PWS PFAS water quality summary, published by the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services. As you can see, one page of this table alone identifies 3 different towns where the 4 PFAS compounds regulated by New Hampshire were found at concentrations exceeding the state's maximum contamination levels. The full study contains results from across the entire state. I recommend tracking down this report anytime a new update is released. It's a great resource for evaluating the importance of having a property's water tested for PFAS contamination. When it comes to testing for PFAS, it's important that you find an accredited laboratory to provide analytical services. Each state should be able to provide a list of approved laboratories for any given contaminant of concern. There are some additional precautions that should be taken when collecting PFAS samples to ensure the most accurate results possible. Due to the prevalence of PFAS in our daily lives, it's important to collect water samples and bottles provided by the laboratory. Your laboratory should be verifying the sample containers they provide are free from PFAS contamination. You don't want to cause a false alarm by using an improper sample container that leaches PFAS into the sample, giving the appearance of a contaminated source. When collecting a PFAS sample, we recommend that the sample handler wash their hands prior to sampling and wear nitrile gloves. Before filling the bottle, open the tap and flush water for approximately 3 to 5 minutes. At this point, without stopping the flow of water, fill the provided bottle. Try not to overflow the bottle, as each one contains a preservative that could be washed out if the bottle is overfilled. Finally, place the sample in a cooler with ice to keep it cold until it's delivered to your laboratory of choice. Make sure to use real ice, as gel refrigerants and the plastic bags or casings that they're housed in may contain PFAS. Let's loop back around to the limits set by the EPA and New Hampshire. I'd like to stress that PFAS are still an emerging class of contaminant. That means the rules and regulations surrounding them are subject to change at a rapid pace. The Biden administration has already indicated that they intend for the EPA to provide updated guidance on PFAS, which may also be coupled with enforceable limits. We still don't know yet if states will fall in line with the EPA's recommendations or if they will each continue on with their own plans. Here at ARA, we're trying to plan for the future. We are currently accredited to test for 24 different PFAS compounds that have been identified as potential risks, including the 4 regulated by New Hampshire. We're also keeping an eye on the available research and working to bring new methods online that will allow us to test for an even wider list of analytes. So you've had your water tested for PFAS and gotten the report back. If all of the PFAS of concern come back below the recommended limits, that's great. But what do you do if significant levels of contamination are found? Thankfully, there are a number of options available. Reverse osmosis, granular activated carbon, and ion exchange filtration systems are all effective at removing PFAS from water. The cost to install each of these systems varies on a case-by-case basis, so you'll need to take your time researching each one and shopping around for a reasonable quote. Analytical laboratories like ARA can offer basic advice to clients as to treatment and remediation options, but we're not the experts in those fields. Because we provide the test results, offering remediational services would be a conflict of interest. Your state and local government should be able to provide informative resources when it comes to treatment options. I'll include a link at the end of the presentation to a useful guide that the New Hampshire DES put together. With all that in mind, when it comes to real estate transactions, having resources and phone numbers ready to go is vital. With how crazy the market is right now, offers are being made and accepted in a matter of days. Most contracts allow 10 days to complete inspections, but laboratory testing can take 1 to 2 weeks. So it's important to get the ball rolling as soon as an offer is accepted. My advice to buyers is to know going in whether or not you want the water tested at a property prior to making an offer. And that's all I have for you today. I know it was a lot of ground to cover for a short presentation, but I hope it proves useful in answering the questions that you and your clients may have about PFAS. A copy of the slides from today's presentation will be made available so that you can easily access these links for further reading. I'd be happy to provide additional resources to anyone that would like them. And for those interested, we have an upcoming presentation on what every New Hampshire realtor should know about hazardous materials. You can follow ARA on social media or sign up for our newsletter to find out more. Thanks for watching today's presentation. If you have any questions that you would like to ask, feel free to reach out to us by phone or email.